συστήματα. Χωρίς να λέω ότι αυτά τα συστήματα θα είναι τα μοναδικά συστήματα που θα μπορούσαν να υπάρχουν σε μια μελλοντική αρχιτεκτονική, απλώς θα μπορούσαν να είναι μέρος μιας μελλοντικής αρχιτεκτονικής του χρηματοπιστωτικού συστήματος. Θα μας δώσει λοιπόν στα ερωτήματα τα πρώτα που μιλήσαμε για το πώς εκδίδει το νόμισμα και πώς λειτουργούν οι τράπεζες. Στο πρώτο ερώτημα λοιπόν στα συστήματα αμοιβαίας πίστωσης είναι ποιος εκδίδει το νόμισμα και είναι τα μέλη της κοινότητας. Έτσι. Και γιατί το κάνουν αυτό? Για να διευκολύνουν μεταξύ τους τις συναλλαγές τους. Πώς γίνεται αυτό? Έτσι, γίνεται χορηγώντας ένα δικαίωμα δανειστού μέχρι ενός ορίου, το οποίο παρακολουθείται, έτσι, και καθαρίζονται αυτές οι συναλλαγές μεταξύ τους. Νομίζω ότι ο Δημήτρης ή ο Μάρτιν θα μας πούνε περισσότερα για τις λεπτομέρειες. Και μπορεί να παραχθεί, ή μπορεί να μην υπάρχει καν σαν φυσικό νόμισμα, έτσι, όταν τα μέλη επιθυμούν να κάνουν συναλλαγές και τα άλλα μέλη τους επιτρέπουν. Τα μέλη λοιπόν συμμετέχουν, έτσι, δίνοντας αγαθά και υπηρεσίες, και όλα αυτά γίνονται μέσα ενδογενώς με στην κοινότητα με τις δικές της δυνάμεις. Συμπερασματικά θα έλεγα η συζήτηση αυτή έχει σημασία, γιατί η νομισματική μεταρρύθμιση ή η μεταρρύθμιση του χρηματοπιστωτικού συστήματος είναι ιστορικά αναπόφευκτη. Στην Ελλάδα ή και σε άλλες χώρες η συζήτηση αυτή για πολιτικούς λόγους είναι σε καταστολή, ενώ δεν θα έπρεπε. Θα έπρεπε η δημόσια συζήτηση ήδη να έχει αρχίσει, γιατί οι προκλήσεις που έχουμε στο μέλλον είναι πάρα πολύ σημαντικές. Και κρατώντας, θα ξεκινήσουμε τη συζήτηση, καλώς στο μυαλό μας ότι οποιοδήποτε μελλοντικό σύστημα δεν θα είναι απομονωτικό. Σήμερα το ευρώ υποτίθεται ότι κάνει όλες τις λειτουργίες του κόσμου μέσω από τη συναλλαγή. Διάφορες συναλλαγές μας, διάφορες λοιπόν λειτουργίες διαφορετικές, οι οποίες δεν είναι απαραίτητα ότι θα γίνονται με το ίδιο και το αυτό μέσο στο μέλλον. Άρα πρέπει να αφήσουμε τον εαυτό μας ελεύθερο να φανταστούμε μια νέα αρχιτεκτονική, να πάρουμε τα στοιχεία από τα πειράματα που ήδη υπάρχουν και λειτουργούν επιτυχημένα και να δούμε πώς μπορούμε να φτιάξουμε ένα νέο σύστημα το οποίο εξυπηρετεί τις ανάγκες και τις προκλήσεις που έχουμε να αντιμετωπίσουμε. Ευχαριστώ πολύ. Δεν θέλω να κρατήσω περισσότερο χρόνο. Δηλαδή, αντιστρέφω τη συζήτηση, γιατί συνήθως μας λένε ότι υπάρχουν κάποιοι φυσικοί νόμοι της οικονομίας, τις οποίες οι κοινωνίες πρέπει να προσαρμόζονται. Πάω αντίθετα, λοιπόν, η οικονομία είναι κομμάτι της κοινωνίας. Δεν πιάνουν δηλαδή αυτό το κόλπο των οικονομολόγων. Πρέπει να εξυπηρετούν τους στόχους της κοινωνίας. Και το βασικό πρόβλημα είναι ότι με αυτά τα νομισματικά συστήματα που έχουμε σήμερα, το political money, ένα χρήμα δηλαδή το οποίο επιβάλλεται πολιτικά, έτσι, και το οποίο μάλιστα σήμερα δεν αντιστοιχεί σε κάποιο αντίκτυπο αξίας. Έτσι είναι.
Επιβάλλουν ένα σημείο όμως σε ψηφία απόδοση. Είναι η κοινωνία και πάνω και κάτω. Οπότε δεν είμαστε
ούτε ένα συνήθω του κύκλου τη οικονομία. Και το πρόβλημα σήμερα είναι ότι είμαστε σε μια νομισματική ένωση, στην οποία οι οικονομίε έχουν τελείω διαφορετικέ ανάγκε. Άρα οι υπουργοί που θα έπρεπε να έχουν τον όμορφο θα έπρεπε να είναι λογικά διαφορετικέ στην κάθε μια οικονομία από του κύκλου του οποίου βρίσκεται. Έτσι. Λοιπόν, δεν υπάρχουν δύο λύσει. Θα γίνουν όλοι στην Γερμανία για παράδειγμα, ή θα γίνουν όλοι στην Γερμανία οικονομικά. Το οποίο δεν το βλέπω.
Δεν είναι αυτό. Δεν ζουν στην Γερμανία σε πολύ ψηλό επίπεδο συνέχεια.
Όχι, δεν μιλάω για τους λαούς. Είναι λίγο πιο σύνθετο, γιατί στην ουσία τώρα υπάρχει ένα πρόβλημα ότι αυτό που ελέγχει την νομισματική κυκλοφορία είναι η εξουσία της κοινωνία. Δηλαδή, είναι πιο σύνθετο το πρόβλημα. Δεν είναι ότι είναι ένα αυτό που είναι για όλους. Έχει παίξει μονόπολη, φανταστείτε έναν παίκτη να είναι ταυτόχρονα και αυτό που κρατάει την τράπεζα.
Οπότε αυτό που λέτε είναι ότι με τη λογική κίνδυνα δεν γνώρισε ο Τέρμιν,
καθορίζουν ουσιαστικά την τομή που πρέπει να έχουν την μνήμη και να λειτουργούν μέσα από αυτό.
Θα ήθελα να απαντήσω σε αυτό που είπατε. Ένα από τα ερωτήματα βασικά του όταν βλέπουμε ένα κλίμα. Και ένα βασικό ερώτημα είναι όχι μόνο ποιο το εκδίδει, που εκδίδεται, αλλά σε ποιον ανήκει όταν εκδίδει. Παραδείγματος χάρη, οι εμπορικές τράπεζες το εκδίδουν κατά 97%, αλλά ανήκει στην κεντρική τράπεζα. Η κεντρική τράπεζα του ευρώ και του δολαρίου είναι ιδιώτη, όπω δεν είναι κεντρική τράπεζα. Και το δεύτερο που ήθελα να προσθέσω είναι ότι όταν ψάχνουμε να δούμε του στόχου που θα έπρεπε να εξυπηρετεί το χρήμα στην κοινωνία, ενδεχομένω θα πρέπει να το συγκρίνουμε και μια κοινωνία που θα μπορούσε να λειτουργεί χωρί χρήμα. Και να εκπληρώνει αυτού του στόχου και να δούμε αν βάλουμε το χρήμα που πληρώνει καλύτερα, χειρότερα, τι αλλάζει.
Και νομίζω ότι τα συστήματα που θα δημιουργήσει εδώ μπορεί και το χρήμα να χρησιμοποιηθεί σαν φυσικό στοιχείο, έτσι, να μην το κάνει.
Ναι.
Θα μας τα εξηγήσει, πιστεύω.
Υπάρχουν πολλά που θα μπορούσαν να υποθούν και συγκρίσεις να γίνουν με διάφορα μεταξύ εναλλακτικών νομισμάτων και ευρώ. Θα ήθελα όμως να αποφύγω αυτή τη συζήτηση, όχι γιατί δεν πρέπει να γίνει, αλλά γιατί δεν είναι τη παρούση, με ενδιαφέρει περισσότερο να εστιάσω στο τι κάνουμε ή τι μπορούμε να κάνουμε τώρα εμείς. Υπάρχει ένα πολύ σπουδαίο κοινό αγαθό που είναι το κοινό χρηματοπιστωτικό μας απόθεμα. Σπανίως συζητάμε γι' αυτό. Είναι αυτή η πίστη που υπήρχε μεταξύ των ανθρώπων ότι θα μπορούσαν να δανειστούν κάτι ή να χρησιμοποιήσουν κάτι τώρα για να το πληρώσουν στο μέλλον. Ήταν αυτό το απόθεμα το κοινό στο οποίο καταφέρναμε παλαιότερα οι μεγαλύτεροι θα θυμούνται τις συναλλαγματικές. Ένα κομμάτι χαρτί που έπεσε τελικά το ρόλο του εκδιδόμενου χρήματος. Έγραφε ότι ρώτησε πάνω το ποσό, το υπέγραφε, μπορούσε να τον μεταβιβάσει. Κάθε οπισθογράφηση έκανε τη συναλλαγματική να έχει ακόμα μεγαλύτερη αξία γιατί ήταν περισσότεροι εγγυητές. Καθώς περνάγαν τα χρόνια, αρχίσαμε όλο και περισσότερο να εκχωρούμε αυτό το κοινό αγαθό, το κοινό χρηματοπιστωτικό μας απόθεμα στις τράπεζες, να τις αφήνουμε αυτές να το διαχειρίζονται. Το γραμμάτιο και η Ιταλία ξεχάστηκε. Η συμφωνία κυρίων στο καφενείο μπροστά σε όλους με χειραψία είχε ήδη γίνει παρελθόν πολύ πιο πριν. Αλλά στην Ελλάδα υπήρχε ακόμα η παγκόσμια πρωτοτυπία της μεταχρονολογημένης επιταγής. Έτσι. Όλοι ξέρουμε πώς ήταν αυτό και οι μικρότεροι το προλάβανε. Ήταν κανονικά η επιταγή είναι πληρωτέα από την Ελληνική Τράπεζα για την εμφανίση. Εμείς όμως βάζαμε μια ημερομηνία πολύ μετά. Την οπισθογραφούσαμε και αυτήν όπως κάναμε με τις συναλλαγματικές και τη χρησιμοποιούσαμε για αυτό το χρονικό διάστημα μέχρι την αποκληρωμή της σαν χρήμα αυτοεκδηλώμενο. Πραγματικά βοηθούσε την οικονομία. Υπήρξαν άνθρωποι που έριξαν επιχειρήσεις, που έφτιαξαν σπίτια, που έκαναν πολλά πράγματα με το εργαλείο αυτό και βεβαίως μετά, επειδή πολλά άλλαξαν η κρίση, καταστράφηκε. Αυτό όμως δεν σημαίνει ότι πάβει να υπάρχει αυτή την ώρα του. Πάβει να υπάρχει η κοινή πίστη, πάβει να υπάρχει το χρηματοπιστωτικό απόθεμα το κοινό μας. Απλά θα πρέπει να κοιτάξουμε νέα εργαλεία προκειμένου να το προσεγγίσουμε. Και αυτά τα εργαλεία ήδη υπάρχουν. Πολλές φορές παίρνουν τη μορφή ενός B2B συστήματος, business to business. Η μία επιχείρηση πουλάει στην άλλη επιχείρηση. Στην πραγματικότητα δεν μεσολαβούν χρήματα που να λάβουν χέρια, αλλά εκαθαρίζονται αυτές οι προπιστώσεις συνήθως μέσα σε κάποιο λειτουργικό σύστημα. Τράπεζες χρόνου, αν και δεν θα μπορούσε κανείς να πει ότι είναι νόμισμα αυτό το πράγμα, αλλά στην πραγματικότητα χρησιμοποιούν έναν παρόμοιο μηχανισμό. Και τα συστήματα ALETS, τα οποία βέβαια παραπέμπουν στο προάστιο κάποιας αμερικανικής ενημερούσας πολιτείας, κάνουν ακριβώς το ίδιο. Υπάρχει πάντα από πίσω μια κοινότητα, είτε είναι μια ομάδα εταιριών, είτε είναι κάποιοι άνθρωποι, είτε είναι κάποιος συνεταιρισμός, οι οποίοι συμφωνούν να εγκαθαρίσουν συνεργαλύσουν μεταξύ τους τις χρεοπιστώσεις, αναγνωρίζουν στα μέλη της κοινότητας ένα χρηματοπιστωτικό όριο. Το κάθε μέλος αποκτά εντός εισαγωγικών πάντα ένα, κατά κάποιο τρόπο, ένα δικαίωμα στην έκδοση χρήματος, ένα δικαίωμα να χρεωθεί απέναντι στους άλλους, πάντα όμως μπροστά σε ένα υπαρκτό αγαθό ή σαν μια υπαρκτή υπηρεσία που είναι έτοιμη εκείνη τη στιγμή να προσφερθεί. Εκείνη τη στιγμή λοιπόν που υπάρχει πραγματικά το αγαθό και είναι σημαντικό αυτό γιατί βγάζει απ' έξω όλο αυτό το προβληματισμό για τον έλεγχο των ροών του χρήματος που έχουν οι κεντρικές τράπεζες με τα fiat νομίσματα, τα οποία έχουν τυπωθεί και περιμένουν να μοιραστούν με τον ένα ή τον άλλο τρόπο, χωρίς την πραγματικότητα να υπάρχει ένα κατάλληλο εργαλείο για να ελέγχει τις ροές τους. Χωρίς να ξέρουμε αν εκεί που θα φτάσουν υπάρχει πράγματι ένα αγαθό που περιμένει να αγοραστεί και κάποιος που έχει ανάγκη να το αγοράσει. Στην περίπτωση των αλληλέγγυων χρεοπιστώσεων και των αλληλέγγυων εγκαθαρίσεων αυτών των χρεοπιστώσεων, το άτομο χρεώνεται μπροστά σε υπαρκτό αγαθό και σε υπαρκτή υπηρεσία. Η κοινότητα αναγνωρίζει τη δυνατότητά του να το κάνει αυτό. Αυτός που παρέχει το αγαθό στο λογαριασμό του προστίθεται κάποιες μονάδες, οι οποίες συμβολίζουν τα χρήματα που θα έπρεπε να έχει πάρει, γιατί έδωσε ένα πραγματικό αγαθό. Αντιστοίχως στον λογαριασμό του άλλου αφαιρούνται οι ίδιες μονάδες, γιατί πήρε κάτι, επομένως οφείλει κάτι να αποδώσει στο μέλλον. Και εδώ έχουμε πραγματικά τη λειτουργία, τουλάχιστον δύο από τις λειτουργίες του χρήματος. Η μία είναι ότι είναι μονάδα μέτρησης το χρήμα και η άλλη λειτουργία είναι ότι μπορεί να αποθηκεύσει αξία στο μέλλον, για το μέλλον. Δηλαδή πραγματικά κάποιος, γιατί σε συστήματα ανταλλαγών, απλών ανταλλαγών, είναι πολύ δύσκολο να εξυπηρετηθούν και οι δύο. Θα πρέπει να συμπέσουν οι ανάγκες προσφοράς και ζήτησης, να συνδέσει ο ένας να έχει κάτι που να είναι επιθυμητό στον άλλον, είναι κάτι πολύ δύσκολο. Όταν το κάνεις αυτό μέσα σε μια κοινότητα, αυτός που είναι χρεωμένος μπορεί να ξεχρεώσει κατά κάποιο τρόπο, αν και είναι κακός ο όρος γιατί παραπέμπει στο χρέος του κρατικού νομίσματος και εδώ δεν πρόκειται για κάτι τέτοιο. Πρόκειται στην πραγματικότητα για λογιστικές εγγραφές. Προσφέροντας κάτι άλλο. Και πάντοτε αυτό το σύστημα είναι μηδέν. Υπάρχουν σήμερα εκατοντάδες κοινότητες σε όλο τον κόσμο που εφαρμόζουν αυτά τα συστήματα των αλληλεγγύων χρεοπιστώσεων. Όσο πιο μεγάλες γίνονται, τόσο πιο δύσκολο είναι να διατηρηθεί το υψηλό επίπεδο πίστης που χρειάζεται για να λειτουργήσει καλά μια τέτοια κοινότητα. Από την άλλη μεριά, όσο πιο μεγάλες γίνονται αυτές οι κοινότητες, τόσο πιο πολύ ευημερούν. Γιατί μπαίνουν διαφορετικοί άνθρωποι μέσα, μπαίνουν διαφορετικές επιχειρήσεις, έχουν διαφορετικές ανάγκες, διαφορετικά αγαθά μπορούν να παράξουν οι υπηρεσίες. Επομένως, η κοινότητα αυτή είναι πλούσια, έχει όλο και περισσότερα πράγματα. Μία ιδανική λύση θα ήταν να έχουμε μικρές κοινότητες από τη μία μεριά, ώστε να έχουμε αυτή την ισχυρή πίστη των μελών και την εμπιστοσύνη του ενός μέλους προς το άλλο, αλλά από την άλλη να μπορούσαμε να τις έχουμε διασυνδεδεμένες, έτσι ώστε να συνεργάζεται μια κοινότητα με την άλλη. Αυτό φαίνεται σε πρώτη φάση εύκολο, δεν είναι όμως. Έχει επιχειρηθεί να γίνει πάρα πολλές φορές, είναι όμως πάρα πολλά τα διαφορετικά λογισμικά στα οποία λειτουργούν αυτά τα συστήματα οι διαφορετικές κοινότητες. Πάντοτε καταφέρνουμε στη τεχνολογία και φτιάχνουμε μια γέφυρα μεταξύ βάσεων δεδομένων ή κάνουμε μια χακιά στο software ώστε το software του ενός να μιλάει με το software του άλλου και τελικά καταλήγουμε με δύο ή με τρεις κοινότητες που μπορούν και συνεργάζονται μεταξύ τους. Και όταν το πράγμα πάει να κλιμακωθεί, τα πράγματα γίνονται πάρα πολύ δύσκολα. Γιατί ο καθένας θέλει να γράψει και το δικό του κώδικα. Εδώ λοιπόν είναι η αξία της προσφυγικής. πρότασης του Μάθιου Σλάτερ και στην πραγματικότητα μιλάει εξ ονόματος όλων αυτών των κοινοτήτων, οι οποίες θέλουν, είναι πολλές, είναι εκατοντάδες από τον κόσμο, θέλουν να συνεργαστούν και δεν χρειάζεται για να μπορέσουν να συνεργαστούν ένα καινούριο υπερπρόγραμμα που να αντικαταστήσει όλα τα άλλα, και ούτε χρειάζονται κάποιο πονηρό να έρθει να τους πουλήσει ένα ενδιάμεσο κρυπτονόμισμα το οποίο τάχαμε θα κάνει τις κινήσεις μεταξύ των κοινοτήτων. Αυτό που χρειάζονται, αλλά δεν ξέρουν να το πούν στον κόσμο του ελεύθερου λογισμικού, και αναλαμβάνει να το πει ο Μάθιου, είναι ένα πρωτόκολλο καλά καθορισμένο, το οποίο να είναι ανοιχτό, να μπορούν εύκολα οι προγραμματιστές να το ενσωματώσουν στο κώδικά τους, το οποίο να αυτοματοποιεί σε καθαρίσεις χρεοπιστώσεων, όχι μεταξύ ατόμων βέβαια, αλλά μεταξύ συστημάτων, μεταξύ κοινοτήτων. Αυτό ήθελα να πω. Σας ευχαριστώ.
Χρειάζεται
κάποιος μετάφραση. Αν κάποιος χρειάζεται μετάφραση, μπορώ να πάω δίπλα του και να του συντηρίζω. Ναι. Όχι. Σίγουρα.
That means I'm speaking in English without translation.
Yes.
Or it does. I don't know how you translate it, because then it gives me a little time to think between each sentence. So I'm very nervous about the technology, and we'll just see how it goes, and I won't let it ruin everything. But we got through the first presentation, okay. I want to thank you for coming. Sometimes it's very difficult to elicit interest in the subject of money and exchange systems. I want to start by telling you something about me, because really I have no authority to speak on this subject. I didn't get an economics degree. I didn't even get a computing degree. I have a theology degree. And then starting at the age of about 27, I taught myself to write software, but not in a serious language, in Macromedia Director. So I was making arcade games for Ben & Jerry's for some years before I learned PHP in 2012. And I don't have anywhere safe that I could sit in a dark room and code. I live a homeless, nomadic lifestyle. And so when I do my work, it's always in between doing other things. That's one reason I'm not very good at PowerPoint. They don't come out in public very often and make presentations. And when I do, I try to do it spontaneously. So I speak to you really with no authority over any subject whatsoever. But I think that's okay, because what I'm trying to tell you is really obvious and self-evident. At least so it seems to me. I want to tell you what I have done, though, that might give you a reason to listen to me. First of all, I built and maintained the community accounting module for Drupal, which is used by getting on for 200 different communities. And that's an open source component to a content management framework. And it means that any community, like the Athens Integral Cooperative here, can take the module, they can take the platform, and they can run their own community website. They can own it themselves and host it themselves, choose the components, put it together. And that means we have a rich environment for experimenting in community software, but also in currency software. Then in 2009, I co-founded an organization, Community Forge, which hosts websites for communities, so that groups that don't have the technical expertise, like Athens Integral Cooperative, can can have a free hosted off-the-shelf website. So we host 170 of those at the moment. And there's a team of volunteers which provide support materials and answers emails. So it's not all on me. Then I maintain this Australian time banking website, which has around 80 communities in it, and that's done with the government of New South Wales. And then I co-authored the Money and Society MOOC, and we've had 1,000 people starting that MOOC and about 200 people finishing it. And I'd encourage you all, hopefully at the end, to have a look at that MOOC and consider doing it yourselves if you're interested in more about the way that the money works. So maybe we covered this a little before, you can rush me if we did, but I want to point out that economics, as it's practiced today in the mainstream, isn't working very well. All the ideas that I want to, that I'm working with, you can find them in economics, but they've been pushed to the side by neoliberal economics. And the concepts are there, you can find them. Things like what is exchange and things, foreign exchange rates and economics of production. You can all read about it, but it's not really discussed in neoliberal economics. So I want to tell you about the two main functions of money. The main function of money, as it's understood in modern society, is as a store of value. And in order to be a store of value, that means that money has to be valuable. And we know it's valuable because there's never enough of it. And if you want to get some, you have to pay to borrow it. We actually rent money from the banks, because we can't get it in any other way. And so money is scarce and valuable. And this is very good to work as a store of value, especially because when you store this money, it gets more valuable through interest. But the other function of money that's much less talked about and arguably is much more important is the medium of exchange. And a medium of exchange currency doesn't have to be valuable. It doesn't even have to exist for a long time. It can exist just for a short time, in between the time when you give something and the time you receive something. And when you've done that exchange, maybe across time and across space, the money which would come into existence in the first half of the exchange can disappear in the second half exchange. And it was never really worth anything, and it was never intended to last. But I don't want to repeat what Demetrius said already in Greek. I hope that you have some idea how money can just come into existence and then vanish again when it's not needed already. So this function of money, the medium of exchange function, is much more important for the real economy. In the real economy, if you'll forgive me using the word real, most of us are producing goods and services and consuming goods and services in almost equal quantity. And so the real economy is mostly about that exchange, that we go out to work and we make things, and then we get the money, and then we spend it on consuming things. And so most of the money that we need doesn't have to be a store of value money. It doesn't have to be valuable. It only has to be there to keep account between what we've given and what we've received. It can be temporary money, and it can be free to issue. And in fact, all you need for that kind of money is an accounting system, which everyone agrees to make reference to trust. So I'm here to talk about complementary currencies. And there are different kinds of complementary currency.
There are two kinds of copyrighted currency which I'm not going to talk about. The first one is the Brixton Pound. And this is a project which helps to keep money circulating in the local community. So what happens is they print up some pieces of paper and they'll sell one piece of paper for £1. They'll put the pound in the bank or in the credit union. And then the piece of paper can only be spent in local businesses. So the idea is to encourage people who receive this piece of paper to spend them in local businesses and not to go and get their pound back out and spend it on cheap imported Chinese goods. So the Brixton Pound doesn't add any new liquidity into the economy, because for every pound that they issue, they take a pound and put it in the bank. So I'm not interested in that kind of currency, because I want to add new liquidity into the economy to help us exchange, to create employment, in fact. Another currency I'm not going to talk about is Bitcoin. It can be argued that Bitcoin has added $10 billion of liquidity into the global economy. But it's not very useful because people are not spending Bitcoin, they're not circulating it. And if you want to spend Bitcoin, you first have to buy it. So we have this similar problem to the Brixton Pound, where maybe there is $10 billion of new liquidity in the global economy, but we can't access it without spending our dollars or our euros. Bitcoin has another interesting use, which is to act as a global accounting system without being a bank. And so you can do transactions in a short period of time at a low cost. But this is not what I'm most concerned about. This is not what I think the economy needs. Instead, the complementary currencies which interest me are exchange systems. We just had quite a long explanation of exchange systems, so I might just skip this section. But I want to talk a little bit about balance. An exchange system means that you balance what you spend and what you earn, what you give and what you receive. If you're giving more than you're receiving, or you're receiving more than you're giving, then what you need is a store of value currency. But insofar as people are giving and receiving in the same quantity, we can use the medium of exchange currency, which is free to issue. It's a form of credit. I think Kimi just explained that already. There are three main models, I would say, of exchange systems. Here's a Greek commercial barter system. I don't know anything about it. You could look it up in your own time. But that's where businesses can go and they can register the business, put their products and services into a list, and then they can look in the list and see what they want to acquire and what they want to sell. And so there's no money going through the system, it's just a unit of account. You start with zero in your balance and you must leave with zero. This is a system in Rhodes where they're running a community board site which they customize themselves, and it's a LEX. And a LEX is it's a community group which focuses on this function of exchange. So they'll declare a unit of account, they have an accounting system, they have a list of offers and a list of wants, and then they'll do all kinds of community activities, including exchange and giving and receiving. This is a Time Bank in the USA. It's got about 3,500 members, last time I checked. It's a very large Time Bank. And Time Banks are very often integrated with social services and people who are looking to improve the community as a whole. So Time Banking is seen as a tool to engage very often poor people or excluded people. And when you give people a unit of account and you give them directory, you're also giving them permission to ask for things from other people in their community. that can be very valuable. And time banking is very good at building community, which is very important in this globalized economy, where we can feel that our communities are being eroded. I found recently Yanis Varoufakis speaking in Australia, and someone asked him, what about complementary currencies? Are they not a solution? And his answer wasn't very encouraging. It was even difficult to make sense of. I'm just going to read it to you. He said, complementary currencies are not going to happen until and unless technology develops to an extent that some of the things we take for granted regarding the nature of capitalism are no longer being programmed. I don't really understand what he meant by that, but what comes through for me is that complementary currencies are not in his mind at all. He's aware that they're out there, it's a possible solution, it's a nice thing, but he's a classically trained economist. He believes that economics is the business of government to sort out. And these complementary currencies that I'm talking about are what people can do for themselves. There's no need to engage with government or to get permission from banks to make private arrangements between each other, to promise each other things. Many people will say that mutual credit systems don't scale. And this is true, that many of them are very small, and many of them have existed for decades without really growing any bigger. But it's not true that they can't scale. So I've got four examples here of large-scale community currency systems. The first one is the Via Bank, which has about 70,000 members who are able to issue credit on the basis that they put their, I think their houses, they commit them to the bank, and then they're able to spend on the basis of that. But it's very like a credit clearing system, and there's only one of its kind in the world. Then Keynes proposed a mutual credit system to go between all the countries. After World War II, in the Bretton Woods Conference, he proposed that they make a new currency called the bancor, which was basically a mutual credit to manage the balance of trade between all the different countries. But they went with another system, the gold standard, in which America was able to issue unlimited dollars and never have to pay back. In Argentina in 2001, there was a currency collapse, but they had some barter clubs already running. It was a thing. So you would come to the barter club and they would rent out a marketplace and you'd bring your stuff, put it on the table. And then everyone would exchange stuff using tickets which were bought when you entered the marketplace. And when the currency collapsed, the barter clubs became very, very popular and important. And so this shows how they went up to, there were 1,800 of them in 2001, and then 5,000 in 2002. And then after that, the government regained some control and stabilized the currency, so the use of barter clubs went down. But also Time Banking UK, they just tweeted today, if I can find the reference, they exchanged in the last year 2.8 million hours, and they have 39,000 members and 5,200 organizations as members. So this is community exchange starting to work at scale. And all of that is happening, I think, without anything going between the time banks. These are all a few hundred local systems which have no real economic connection between each other. They're just all under one umbrella organization. So what are the reasons for community currencies, in particular exchange systems, not scaling? It's a great
concern to me that these amazing community organizations seem to stay small. And sometimes you can argue that small is beautiful, but we really need alternatives on a much bigger scale if the economy is going to function in our interests. Very often, local currency projects have rejected money. It's been the values of those people that they don't want anything to do with money. And so there are systems in Belgium where the government has said to them, we want to support you, here's some money. And they say, no, no, we don't want anything to do with the government. And so if you think that's a good thing or a bad thing, it's one thing that keeps them small. Another problem is that in these exchange systems, you have always some people with a positive balance and other people with a negative balance. Because if I owe you 10, that's the currency. That means I'm down 10 and you're up 10. And there's no shame about that, but it's not like the debt where you've got the compound interest to be paid to the bank. But some people feel that to be negative is a bad thing, and so they will refuse to use these systems properly because they don't understand. So that's another limitation to their scaling. When you have 2.8 million hours circulating in England, and maybe you multiply that by €5 an hour, I don't know, what do you get? €15 million. That £15 million or euros is completely invisible to the government and to the economists. This is stuff that people are doing for each other, but because it doesn't have a value in the national currency, nobody wants to look at it. Nobody officially acknowledges that there's value being created there. And if there were actually pounds being exchanged, like if they were not trading hours, but they were trading £5 notes, suddenly it would become a lot more interesting to the authorities. But time banking receives very little support from governments. There are business barter systems as well, hundreds of them, thousands of them. And there are reasons why I think that they're not succeeding very well. Partly because they have to pay tax, and it's not very fair if I do something for you and you do something for me, that it's taxed on both sides, and that it's taxed in dollars when the trade happened for our own goods and services. Like if we're trading and there's no dollars, how can the government take dollars out of that situation? It makes it completely unsustainable. So the law around that prevents the business barter systems from being really useful. But worse than that, in the business barter systems, they're all owned by groups who need to maximize their own profit. And so these groups will tax the transactions and they'll charge membership fees. And then if they trade between the systems, they'll pay another fee as well to the software provider who owns the network. And so that means that the exchange that's done between the business systems is very heavily penalized. And it means that people don't really want to participate in business barter very often. There's another problem that small exchanges, many of them only have 20 really active members, but even ones with 100 active members, they don't have a very big marketplace, and it's not very easy always to find something to give and find something to receive with a small group of people. When you have a very large economy, everybody can contribute and everybody can find what they want, but when you have hundreds of small economies, it can be very difficult. And so, if there was more in each marketplace,
they could grow, and they would grow if there was more. It's a chicken and egg problem. Many of the people involved in community exchange systems lack professional experience. And that means that they're not actively pursuing fundraising, or they're not geniuses at public relations, and they're not aggressively growing their organizations. So the organizations don't grow. So that's a cultural reason. Sometimes when projects are funded, they forget to specify that the software produced should be open source, or that they should share what they learn with other groups. And so there's, it's only occasional, but big piles of money go into the complementary currency movement, and then nothing comes out, at least from what I can see. Anyway, that's a lot of problems. I'm offering a solution. One of the major barriers to all of these hundreds, if not thousands, of local systems thriving is that they can't communicate with each other. They're all using different software and different currencies, and they're very often locally focused. And if someone wants to take some of their credit or debt to another place, to spend it in another marketplace, it's absolutely impossible. These are closed systems. It's not like a commodity money where you can take something valuable and it's valuable everywhere, even if you have to exchange it. This is credit that's only useful in the local community. And so if you're going to get your credit honored in one community or in another community, you have to have an arrangement between the two communities. So the Credit Commons is about making a protocol for communities to arrange to honor each other's credit, just as within a community, the members are agreeing to honor each other's credit. If these hundreds and thousands of complementary currencies could be interoperable, they would make not a movement of lots of things going on in different places, but they would become coherent. It would be something that would be much more able to grow, because it would be one thing with one protocol, with one language. But I'm not trying to suggest that all of these independent groups who are trying to be resilient, who are trying to be self-managing, I'm not saying they should join a new organization or migrate onto a new software platform. This is a protocol for communication and a protocol for trust. So what I'm saying is they should get together and agree to honor each other's credit, and then implement the protocol in their software, so that they have a good user experience of paying each other. Last year, I worked with Thanasis over here. I don't know if he's known in this group. Are you known, Thanasis?
Slightly.
Thanasis lives in Switzerland, and together we wrote, and with Vasilis Kostakis, we wrote a 80-page proposal for a CAPS, European Union grant. CAPS means Collective Awareness Platforms for Sustainability. And they didn't like it. But it was a very useful experience, because in doing that, I went around everybody I know in complementary currencies, and that was people like Timebanks USA, Timebanks UK, the Let's Movement in France, Let's Movements in Germany and Switzerland and Austria and a few others. And we got a big list of partners, and they all said, yes, we want the Credit Commons. And they put their names on this document. So even if we didn't get 1.2 million euros, it showed that we have something in common, a
and that we desire to work together. And with that coalition, we were representing tens of thousands of users of these exchange systems around the world. And that was without the business barter systems. We weren't talking to them at all. So this solution, the Credit Commons, is not actually very complex, but it does involve that we think about money in a different way, as I explained earlier. The reason I'm calling it the Credit Commons is because it supports the common people, which in this case is you and me, to issue credit to one another without the intervention of banks and the state. It's simply a matter or an extension of the idea that I can write, I owe you maybe not 10 euros, but maybe 10 melons. And I can hand that to you and then you can trade that with somebody else. So I'll owe somebody else 10 melons when they bring it back to me. It's a completely private arrangement. And the Credit Commons describes how that simple relationship can be scaled up. It's not simply a matter of making one big network, because we have all these exchanges already. I don't want to take those away. And it's not simply a matter of making an exchange of exchanges, which some people have thought of before. It's a question of making a fractal structure, where you have exchanges of exchanges of exchanges. It doesn't matter how many layers there are. And then any group of people or any group of exchanges can make an exchange and then trade with other exchanges. And they can do that layer upon layer upon layer. So it begins with specifying the protocol for how we trust each other. So there's just a few things. I'm not going to go into them now because I wrote a white paper about it. And there's a link there, on creditcommons.net. But we have to think of it in terms of the social side of the protocol, which is about the people agreeing, and then the technical side of the protocol, which is about connecting your accounting system to everybody else's. And in the middle, between all the accounting systems, I suggest we use a blockchain, something like Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is wonderful because there's no one central authority who can hack the system or discount records or charge high transaction fees because they own the network. And so I'd like to take those principles into another system where instead of Bitcoin being issued on the basis of mining, you just keep a ledger or many ledgers, and they're in the cloud and they cannot be hacked, but we can all write to them. And that way, with the blockchain infrastructure, that's consistent with the commons. So, time for the conclusion. It's still 15 lines here. Since shortly after the crash, I've been racing around the world, writing software and visiting local projects. Like, I really thought the economy was over and we had to do something about it very urgently. So I'm very happy I was wrong, that the urgency is still there. And we've been in, maybe not a global recession, but a recession of the Western economies for nearly 10 years now, which is unprecedented. Some people think the recession is going to end, but I don't think that way. I think it's the end of our current money system. It's just dying very slowly. I do notice, as I'm going around the world, that there's more interest around the subjects of money and around what we can do ourselves. But I don't see that interest translating into successful complementary currency systems because of all those obstacles I mentioned before. And I don't think it's something that I could do by myself.
to offer these solutions. I've done a lot by myself. I've helped a lot of communities to run their own software, but the business of making them all interoperable is really beyond me. So I'm looking for people and organizations who want to help build another economy, a parallel economy, an informal economy, a commons economy, from the grassroots. And this involves getting funding and producing software, but it also involves other things. So it's not just about who can we ask for money. It involves exploring economics, seeing from the perspective of exchange, instead of seeing from the perspective of bank lending, bank credit, which is the assumption of economics now. It involves encouraging larger actors, such as businesses, and maybe local government, to issue credit in a way that it can be circulated and used to help exchange. It involves working with the government to carve out a little space in the law that will allow exchange without money, without taxing it punitively. It's a bit of a grey area in law at the moment. It involves recognizing the role of the grassroots and all the things that ordinary people are doing in their communities to contribute to economic development. Economic development isn't just sending people on courses and getting them through education and getting them into jobs. You also have to make sure that they grow up in a healthy way, that their bodies and minds are fit. And that's not recognized in the economy at the moment. That's very often what's going on when the grassroots is functioning. It's producing people who are ready for the economy, but it's not acknowledged as the economy itself. And it also involves supporting energetic amateurs to be more effective and better connected. So this white paper I've written is intended for everyone here to read. It's not very specialist. I'm working on another paper right now, which is concentrating on the accounting aspects of the credit commons, because I've tried to explain to people about how mutual credit accounting works. And it's really hard. If people have been educated in normal accounting, they just can't understand how simple it is just to keep a ledger of transactions. So I'm writing a new paper to basically explain just that. And we have a volunteer now in Colombia who's attempted to code the credit commons using Ethereum, which is something I hope many people here are familiar with. It's like a development of Bitcoin, but it's not about the currency. It's really a global computer, a computer on the blockchain. And we could use that computer to keep the credit commons accounts. So as the formal economy implodes in debt, the informal economy needs to be ready to jump into its place. Because if the formal economy goes away and there's nothing there, what's going to happen? So the credit commons is a way that anyone who brings goods and services to market and who is trusted by their suppliers and by their customers can exchange those goods and services with anyone else in the world without the encumbrance and the expense of money, and without being blocked by banks who say, you can't afford to do this. So I believe the future is uncertain, but such a tool as this could be our salvation. That's the end of the presentation. Just before we take questions and have a discussion, there's all evening for that, I want to remind you that there is a MOOC, a massive online MOOC course, which I co-authored with my friend Professor Jen Bendel, and it's associated with his university. And it's called the Money and Society MOOC. So you can find that online. Also next year in Pelion, There's a retreat centre called Kalikalos, and the teacher Tom Greco will be running a retreat there. He did so this month, and I was there. A retreat on the subject of how to build local exchange systems. So I'll tell you about that if you ask me after. And secondly, please follow me on Twitter, where you'll find my name, Max Latz, there, and I'm also using a hashtag, Credit Commons, to talk about everything related to this idea. Can we have someone to chair the discussion?
So if there is any questions for Matthew?
Thank you very much for the talk. You mentioned about scalability, which is a great issue in order to see something more going on. An issue behind scalability is trust. So how do you propose we should build trust within the community or between communities? So everything is fair. I mean, your 1 hour of coding is fair to exchange with 1 hour of consulting. So how we should manipulate the trust issue?
So the reason that the system is fractal is because of that. It means that each group can be of a size where trust is working and governance is possible. So we already have the groups at the local level where they're trusting each other. And groups can talk to each other and build trust because they can meet face to face. So all groups in Athens, for example, might agree to honor each other's hour currency at the same value. And so I'm just saying that that could be scaled up. So all the groups in Athens could then make a group with Thessaloniki and Volos. You could have exchange rates between the cities. And it would still be groups, 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 which are small enough to manage. Does that make sense?
Okay. But it is not something like, there's not a place worldwide. It is a group to group.
Well, then you could have national groups and continental groups.
Okay, I see. Thank you.
And give some collectivity grades to the intellectual property. Now, property now is the reality key. Money exists for the sole reason because there is private property. If there is no private property in society, there is no need of money at all. Because there is private property and we need to change its size, I want more of this property and less from this, we need a liquidity medium, and this is money. So we have problem with money because some centers of society monopolize the way that money is issued and lended, and money becomes power. So don't we create property commons? We go directly to the private property idea instead of money or credit, because private property is the root of money. So as with creating commons, we have extended the idea of intellectual property, which is, this is my book, I control it completely, you cannot take anything from there, you cannot use it, you cannot, blah, blah, blah. And then we have creating commons, and we make grades of this control over the intellectual property. You see, yes, you can use it, but you cannot make money from this. Or you can use it, but you cannot change it, or you can change it, but et cetera, et cetera. Now we can do the same with things with property. The classical capitalist, the classical wealthy man, already knows that and talks about two types of property. My household property, I have two, three houses, one boat, a limo, a smaller plane, because I'm rich. And then there is the surplus wealth. I have also 70 companies, like on us, for example. And this wealth, it's not like my household, it's social function, right? I control it, but it belongs also to the society. So they talk about two types of property, my household property and the surplus wealth property. So we could create degrees of property, and this property could come from people. We have a household, which is a small property, but there are parts of our household, even our place, or books, or CDs, or something else, that we could share with other people. We might require small control, but not absolute. They can use it definitely for some limited time. It can never come back to me, or it will come back to me, etc. And by offering parts of our property collectively, we might create a pool of wealth, which is not controlled by the state. We have the right to do it because we can make presents, and the law says, yes, you can offer your house for free if you want, or your laptop if you want for free to use it, etc. And we do need a proper protocol of controlling this decrease of property and sharing it. How do you find this idea?
I think it's a different and complementary idea. I don't feel a need to respond a lot to it. It's nice.
Hi, I'm Christiana Berlichiotti, and I have been attending the InnoVatens program. I'm a graduate of the InnoVatens program, and I am building the Meraki people, which is a movement or a community in Mount Parnonas. So I guess I am the guinea pig of your work. And I would like people in here to go into the Meraki people, and I have Meraki people in Facebook and Meraki people as a community. My name is Christiana Berlichiotti, so you can trace me. And if people are interested about seeing actual people in actual community in Greece, please do contact me. I do need every person's help, including yours.
Can you spell it for me?
Yes. Which one, the Christiana or the Meraki?
Meraki.
M-E-R-A-K-I, people. It's the Meraki people. Facebook, closed group, and the Meraki people, open community. And then it's Christiana Berlichiotti. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Thanos Politis. Here in Greece, we have two problems. I think it's the same problems with the Creative Commons. One problem was the fair perception of inflation. And the second problem, the problem of the creating of registration about the products and the services. How will we resolve these problems?
Mr. Second problem, can you say that again?
The second problem, the registration, the reliability of registrations. Registrations.
What happens if registrations are
registered for the products or the service? I want to make a deal with the Creative Commons. My elements, it's true. My products, it's a quality. My services is good. It's fairly.
This exchange networks, where your community decides to give you credit, they won't give you credit if they don't know who you are. You have to be a member of a community. They have to know your face and know what you produce. So it doesn't make sense that you might register twice. Is that answer?
Okay.
And regarding inflation, it is possible to have inflation inside a mutual credit system. It doesn't look like inflation, usually. What happens is you have liquidity freezes up because there's too many people with credit and not enough people with debt. So there's too many people looking to spend and not enough people looking to earn. So when the system goes out of balance like that, there can be problems. But a well government system should not go out of balance. Does that answer your question?
Another question as well, or perhaps two questions. One is starting from the comment made by the previous member of the audience, Kiritic, was the name, right? That was in relation to Creative Commons. Of course, Commons is a broader term. It's not invented by Creative Commons by any means. But I was thinking, I too initially had a problem, and maybe still do, with the term Creative Commons, because I understand that you're thinking of it as credit from one person to another, or as an IOU of some kind.
I'm calling the Creative Commons Protocol.
And I think
Tom Greco has already written about the Creative Commons as something which exists in intellectual space, but I'm saying we need a protocol to do it.
But to make it more concrete, I think, for example, I don't know if this is already in your thinking, maybe, that you could consider credit that is not somebody's property, so that if I, for example, I have a positive balance, I can give that back to a common pool. Because sometimes we are very productive, sometimes we produce a lot, sometimes we consume a lot. Sometimes there isn't anything in a time bank or any exchange system that we actually need. So we have a positive balance that's just sitting there and possibly accumulating, or maybe we are forced to make it zero again, which will not always work. So it would make sense to have also a common pool where I can take my positive balance and give it back to the common pool so that somebody else who might have a need for something that is actually on offer can use that. And then, in my mind, credit would become a commons. Otherwise, it is not. Otherwise, it's just an exchange system and it has nothing to do with commons.
The reason this credit is common is in comparison to the credit which is issued by banks. And that credit is private property and it's rented to us. So it's common because anyone in principle can create this credit.
But if it's not in a shared pool, then it's not commons.
It's the right to create it which is common.
That's not commons. It's a completely different thing. The commons is a different thing from the word common, as I'm sure you know. Anyway, that's just my feeling about it now. And secondly, I like the idea about the protocol. I mean, I have a technical background, so that's what everybody with a computer science degree will tell you. They will tell you you need a protocol.
Good.
Right? Why are you building it?
Why am I building it?
Or are they specifying the protocol? Is there a specification of the protocol?
I'm working towards one.
Because that is usually a group effort that needs to happen, ideally involving also members of communities that already can specify the needs that they have.
Yes, I'm working towards one with other people, with people who know much more about accounting and technology than I do.
Oh, okay, so this is going to happen? Depends on the resources, I guess.
Well, insofar as it would be a blockchain specification, I don't have those experts yet.
Well, to specify the protocol, I'm not entirely sure, but I don't think that to specify the protocol, you need to think about blockchains. You just need to think about what kind of transactions you need to have.
And I'm thinking about it as a REST API at the moment, and moving towards that.
Okay. Well, it's a more technical discussion there that maybe doesn't interest everybody here. Thank you.
Okay. Happy to continue that.
This is a very valid discussion, actually, because this is touches more the social engineering part, I think, the thinking when you bring communities together to do stuff. So it has nothing to do with the blockchain or the REST API. It's more about the rules that we need to make people agree where they would want to use a protocol to, let's say, publish their changes, because this is what it's about. Actually, this is about taking existing exchanges that happen in the community already and people that trust each other, and then making them public in a blockchain, because this is now it's the most easy way to make something transparent and verifiable so people can use it. And this is the idea of the protocol. But you're right in insisting on the protocol part, because it's much more like a social process that you need to rethink.
Protocol can be technology agnostic.
Exactly.
It doesn't depend on
the situation. Exactly. And the work that we are doing is surpassing the API of the blockchain. It's more about the philosophy of how you treat these transactions, how you post them, how they'll be used. So it's a valid point. What I want to say, having worked a little bit on this issue, is that it's an issue which is non-historical. I mean, it's very difficult to find an example where we can really demonstrate how this scaling up of transactions could happen in a, say, in a larger scale. We know we have seen credit circulating in economies, but it's mostly between individuals. And then we have a problem to capture how groups can actually exchange credit. So this is something very different. It's something very interesting because it lets all the discussion happen, so we can imagine property, we can imagine transactions, we can imagine many things. But it's very hard for me also to explain to people how a network credit would make sense. So this is the challenge actually from after these meetings of this time to try to elaborate more on these ideas. Wikipedia is a place, for example, where knowledge has been, let's say, a commons, but knowledge is something which is material. Knowledge, we have many years discussing how it's important to share knowledge. So everybody's saying free knowledge, but nobody's saying free money. So we need to work with this kind of parts also when discussing this issue.
Hi, my name is Christos Telasoudas. We've seen the Eurozone fail because it created a monetary union, but not a political union or a fiscal union. So, is your project working also towards some kind of the creation of a political entity with a political agenda, and what would be such an agenda? And don't take it negatively. For example, I would like a political agenda that would aim towards an equitable wealth distribution and the respect for people's human rights. So I would like, because money is a tool and it's a weapon, and today we are witnessing a global economic war, and I wouldn't put it west and east, and it's just various centers of power fighting for control of the people. And if, as a community, we aim to find ourselves, to make for ourselves a space to live within this environment, we also need a political union, a political agenda, and maybe that should come first, or at least work towards it in parallel. The technical issue of creating the coin?
That's a great question, thank you. For me, my focus is about getting a money system which works for us and which will therefore enable us to be more productive. You could call it power to the people. Is that a political agenda? Because once you give power to the people, you can't tell them what to do with it. So you can't put another political agenda onto that. It's my aim to move the power from the top of the pyramid to the bottom. And I think that working on the money system is one way to do that. But any other politics which arises out of it, I wouldn't know. And then I wouldn't want to specify. Okay?
Can just say two words about Sardex and explain a bit how Sardex works, so people maybe then we feel more comfortable with the idea of...
I forgot to mention Sardex.
Yes, you did. So, so just say about how Mutual Credit works, how business to business barter. No, no, go ahead. Business barter in Sardex.
Well, Sardex is on TradeNow.gr, which is a system I know nothing about.
Yeah, but Sardex is credit.
But there's a system running in Sardinia and latterly around Italy, they've got about five different exchanges. It's called Sardex, which is a Sardinian exchange, I guess. And what else to say about it? They seem good, they're growing, they're interested in opening an exchange in Greece and other places. They're looking at how they would exchange between those different exchanges. But I've never met them. Is there anything else you think I should say?
Yes, we had the opportunity to listen to Giuseppe Pita, I think, who was one of the founding members of Sardex in the summer school in the University of Thessalia in Poland 3 years ago. And then I continue exchanging letters with Giuseppe, who explained me most of what Sardex is doing. And I consider it very successful in Italy. Right now, I think the volume of transactions that go on through this complementary currency is about 80 million, I think. So they have increased the GDP of Italy. And the state is happy because they do pay taxes in Europe. But of course, the idea is that there are resources, there are people to know how to produce services and goods. There is demand, but there is no euro. So it's a pity to freeze the economy. So they created the idea of Sardex. It was inspired by the Bilbao. It was a group of students. They wanted to do some good to Sardinia locally. They had this local idea that I don't want to have my city, my town. So they used the idea of a zero-sum credit between a group of people that you will offer to the collective as much as the collective will offer to you in some 1 year time. And at the beginning, they use a special software, I think it's Cypress, I'm not very sure. And for the first 1 or 2 years, they had to pass the critical mass of a number of people involved, so each member will find some sufficient many goods and services to exchange, otherwise it was meaningless. There was demand because of the crisis that there is no euro in Italy too. And the idea that, for example, you don't have money to go to the dentist, and the dentist could offer you some services if you do have money, but you don't. And if you go to the dentist and you are credited by Sardex, and then the dentist takes the Sardex, which is just recording the computer, and goes to the supermarket, which is also a member of the Sardex, and can buy some goods, right? It's equally good to the dentist as if he was paid in euro. And they do produce this paper stuff or the accounting paper stuff for the tax service, and they do pay taxes as if the transaction was going on in euro. The clever idea that these people had, which is completely different from the Greek local currencies, is that they focus not on persons, but on enterprises, business. and they ask the business that they commit that they offer at least 10% of their sales through Sardex. Of course, if they were asked to. And the business were attracted by this idea because they saw profit. They say that if I do that, I would have more sales, more people buying my clothes, my food, my room service, whatever, right? And they use many people in the telephone that speak with businessmen and explain why it's profitable for them to do that. And it's like a telephone marketing. And after 1 or 2 years, they passed this critical mass, and then they started having real business with the local community. It was so successful that even the local government asked to participate because they didn't have money either. So they had to offer energy, I think, and exchange the other services from the local communities, the city. And at the beginning, they charged some percentage of the transaction, I think 5%. But later they considered it too much, so they said, no, it's free, but you pay some monthly fees to participate in the system. Now the banks cannot compete with it because they bank in the bank, if you want to lend, to borrow money from the bank, you have to pay interest. While in this way, the Swiss credit doesn't have interest at all, it's free of interest. So it's more profitable for the company to use this credit system than go to the bank and borrow money. And so the state is happy because it's gaining more taxes in this way, and the GDP is increasing. So this spread into 5 more areas in central Italy, which is not Sardinia. They use the same principles, the same software, but they call it in different names. Every time the name was the local city. For example, if it was in Volos, it would be called Volos. I don't know. If it was in Preveza, it would be called Prevex. Or Patra, Patrex, something like this. But it was the same software.
And that means
Parmenas?
Parmenas.
Yes. Yes, exactly. So, they're quite happy, they are growing, they are expanding, and I think it's a successful model, which also advised big co-currencies to do the same thing. For this, of course, in this you need the advice from lawyers and accountants to see that with the capital controls in Greece, that it is possible to have a kind of credit through a software like this, which exchanges services and goods, and you don't exchange money at all, but only at least at 10% you don't exchange money, which means that the system should be, the law should be allowed that. But in Italy, it is possible, and they told me that at least before the capital controls, it is possible in Greece too. So that's the story of Sardex.
It should be a viable business for somebody to do.
Yes, these people live from this, they make good money, but they want some ethics. They are not interested to make money. They're interested to help their local city. That's the idea. And that's how they persuade everybody to participate. It's for the good of the city, the good for of our island or
that's what makes them special compared to so many other business partner networks.
Exactly. And at this point I would like to ask you that Sardex, for example, Sardex is an example of zero sum credit, also the Greek credit system. But there are other, like even in German for example, which is positive sum, like Cardido, right? Which is of Hoek's, Ben Hoekstra, who is positive sum, which means that the fare is not that you offer so much as the community offers to you, the fare is that the community offers you more than what you offer to the community, because the community is larger, there are more people, older, so it's natural that from society you receive more than what you offer society. And they have created a kind of local currency in the internet, which is positive sum, and also provides the minimum income to every member. So I would like to ask you if this protocol that you suggest could support also positive sum credit systems.
I call those fiat systems, where they're issuing the units out of nothing. The credit commons protocol doesn't specify what kind of local currency can participate. It specifies that different projects, different community groups should come together and make agreements about exchange rates between them.
So in principle, Credito could cooperate with Starbucks?
If they can agree on an exchange rate.
Okay.
Thanasis wanted to say something.
I was just thinking of the Starbucks example because it shows how a closed, let's say, network can exist in Canada. Because Starbucks remains closed, that's why you don't need the protocol actually, because it's then the offer, the host system itself. But now, what Matthew was saying is that what is the protocol that we need for different kinds of Starbucks or other entities to now transact between themselves and within the members? And this is, that's why I insist that sometimes works, as Starbucks works. Presentation, but the idea is now how do you take this transaction that framed in Starbucks and change with other communities and allow this kind of transactions to continue to happen outside Starbucks. This is a way of reframing what you said before.
Hi, Alekos Palazis from Google Peer Lab. Maybe my question has not sense, meaning, but I was wondering if the different alternative economic networks, they all are upon one X currency is equal to 1 euro, for example, or to $1, then there's not a meaning in what I'm wondering, but if it's different currency or community has to come to a common conclusion that we value 1 kilo of tomatoes, for example, with this, equal to this, or we do the exchange, you know? So there has to be an agreement, in my imagination at least, in the value of the products and the services. So is there a problem in connecting different economic networks with this very nice work that you're doing, in that they might have different values, they might have different arrangements about how much a kilo of tomatoes are cost.
Yes, that's a philosophical problem, and you see the same thing in the global system of exchange rates now, which is why I just heard that you can buy a fan from the shop from China for 10 euros. It's completely ridiculous, and it's unjust to the Chinese. You can build fairer exchange rate systems, but they depend on good human politics between the people involved.
Okay, so this has to have a communication between the communities so that they generate that. And an instant thought that it just came to me, so I haven't think about it a lot, but I was watching a talk from Yorgos Kalis from the Degrowth Movement, and he was analyzing like that each community was having a surplus value, which were doing something with this, either for the good of the community or big celebrations or destroying it. And the characteristic of capitalism is that it takes all this surplus value and invests it in order to have more growth and more value. So just it's less to be like thinking about whether it be a surplus value in such a system, or what we could do, or if there won't be a surplus value, just like thought like that. Thanks.
I'm sure there would be exactly the same surplus value, but you might not assume what to do with it. If we were deciding together what to do with it and managing our relations with other communities, we might put the surplus value to other use than just to growth.
One more one more thought, continuing from the previous. Is there going to be some sort of criterion for accepting communities into the system, like political criteria? Or
it's just the same as when you decide if you trust someone enough to issue them credit, they join a group and the group issues them credit. So there has to be membership criteria both for individuals and for communities looking to join groups of communities.
Would it be possible for a commercial project to join the network?
Yeah, the reason why not, if they can find some friends. But they also have commercial projects forming their own groups.
Yeah.
And they don't even have to have any relations with any other groups because it's just a protocol.
Is it possible that in this universe of interconnected communities and projects, there is one or two that are efficient enough to grow and overshadow or dominate the rest?
No, because each community is using its own currency for its own purposes. And they set limits on how much credit can come out of one community and into another community. So they can't do, for example, what Wall Street does to Latin American countries, flooding them with credit and then changing the value of the credit. That's not possible because it's based on the autonomy of each community.
Yes. For example, if one community decides to use expansionary policies, it achieves value. Like the dollar has a reserve status. So maybe there's a community that's managed efficiently and its units have value, recognized universally, or at least in a wider scale than other communities. Then would not that be...
No, because no group can act unilaterally within its larger group. Everything is about governance and cooperation.
So there will be some sort of central policy regarding monetary parameters?
Not central, but every group, a group of groups, would have its own policy. So there's policy at many different levels, and it's made by the people who are in the groups.
Okay.
There's no overall policy for the credit commons. And everyone is participating voluntarily. And everyone joins a group voluntarily. With the consent of themselves and of the group. And all the credit that goes between the members is limited by the group that it's in. So one group can't unilaterally say, well, we're going to issue our credit to everybody and they must accept it, because there'll be limits. But the group agreed on how much credit can go between groups and what is safe. The limits on trust.
Okay.
Is there any question for Matthew? Okay. Thank you.